Pokemon based on marine biology. Wailord is inspired by the blue whale. It is the largest of all Pokemon known, swimming languorously in the vast open sea. With a height of 14.5 meters, Wailord can dive to depths of 3,000 meters in a single breath. In Pokemon Black and White, you can spot a Wailord in the marine tube around 3 p.m. to 4 p.m. each day. Wailord is gargantuan, humongous, colossal in size. Naturally, it consumes massive amounts of food using their large mouths to help sustain its enormous body. Qwilfish is based on pufferfish. Specifically, it might be based on Japanese fugu fish, since its beta name was called puku, which is a corruption of fugu. Fugu fish contains tetrodotoxin, making it notoriously poisonous if prepared incorrectly. Tetrodotoxin can paralyze, cause respiratory depression and fatal asphyxiation in tiny doses. It is no surprise that Qwilfish is part poison type. Qwilfish may have some naval mine inspiration due to the similarity in its physical appearance. Mantine is based on manta rays, flat-bodied cartilaginous fish. It almost resembles a kite and is often seen leaping out of the water majestically. Remoraid have frequently been sighted scavenging leftovers underneath Mantine, while Mantine seems unbothered by its presence. Remoraid was supposed to be a gunfish. Its beta design was physically modeled after a revolver, but these gun-like characteristics appear to be subdued in the final design. Remoraid's relationship with Mantine suggests it is also inspired by Remora, or suckerfish. They cling on the underside of larger marine animals using a specialized suction disc on their heads, which are heavily modified dorsal fins. By attaching to the underside of larger marine animals, they can hitch a free ride and get free food scraps. Octillery originated as a tank in Pokemon Gold and Silver's 1997 demo. They ditched the tank motif in development. However, its Pokédex entry from Pokemon Gold still appears to reference the original design through Octillery's rock-hard head. Octillery is also obviously inspired by Octopus. Horsea, Seadra, and Kingdra are based on seahorses and sea dragons. Notably, one of its Pokédex entries alludes to the fact that seahorses are the only vertebrates known where the male seahorse gives birth. Every spring, the females each lay several thousand eggs on seaweed, but most end up as fish bait. The males raise the young. Horsea keep balance using their spirally coiled tail. When they sense danger, they may split black ink. Hippocampus, a structure of the brain involved in regulating learning and memory, comes from seahorse. Shellos and Gastrodon are based on sea slugs. One game developer mentioned that there was a sea slug Pokemon that they weren't able to put into Pokemon Ruby and Sapphire, but was able to make the cut in Pokemon Diamond and Pearl. Gastrodon and Shellos appear specifically based on nudibranch, which are soft-bodied, marine invertebrate gastropod mollusks. These are sea snails that have seemingly lost their shells over evolutionary time. Sea slugs have incredibly diverse body shapes, colors, and sizes. They often have strikingly bright colors and ornate patterns. Gastrodon's horns appear inspired by cattle horns. This could be a visual pun based on the Japanese words for sea slug, umi ushi, umi for sea, and ushi for cow or cattle. Kavanha is based on piranha. Kavanha's red underside is similar to that of the red-bellied piranha, and its razor-sharp teeth allow it to rip out boat hulls. They won't hunt alone, instead they will wait for other Kavanha to join them so that they can attack as a group. Sharpedo is likely inspired by the great white shark, one of the most iconic and misunderstood marine predators. Its design appears to draw heavily from the popular stereotype of sharks as ferocious, hyper-aggressive, and relentless killers, a perception largely shaped by the 1975 film Jaws. This exaggerated portrayal of sharks as mindless predators has had a lasting influence on popular culture, and it is reflected in Sharpedo's aggressive appearance and behavior in the Pokemon universe. Sharpedo's Pokédex in Pokemon Moon references a real-world issue of shark finning, the practice of hunting shark fins and discarding the rest of the shark carcass for shark fin soup. Overfishing for shark fins has contributed to the global decline in shark populations. In response, many countries have banned shark finning to protect these vital ocean predators. Additionally, Mega Sharpedo looks to be based on saw sharks due to its protruding snout. Luvdisc may be based on the kissing gourami and discus fish species because of its kissing behavior and laterally compressed body shape. Conversely, it might simply be a heart shape rotated sideways. Corsola is inspired by coral, marine animals made up of tiny polyps that build hard calcium carbonate skeletons, forming coral reefs in tropical waters. These reefs are vital ocean ecosystems, supporting a wide variety of marine life and rich ocean biodiversity. Finneon and Lumineon seem to be based on freshwater butterfly fish. Specifically, Finneon's tails and Lumineon's fins resemble butterfly wings. This deep-sea Pokémon crawls on the bottom of the seafloor using its two pectoral fins in search for food. Principally, Lumineon exhibits bioluminescence, the ability to emit light through chemical reactions within their body to attract prey, and sometimes even their predators. One breakthrough study suggests that 3 in 4, or 75% of deep-sea animals are bioluminescent, making it a major ecological trait for inhabitants of the deep ocean. Perhaps the most well-known bioluminescent Pokémon are Chinchou and Lanturn, which are inspired by deep-sea anglerfish. In nature, the light produced by anglerfish is usually generated by symbiotic bioluminescent bacteria housed in a specialized lure. In marine organisms, bioluminescence generally results from a luciferin-luciferase reaction. Luciferin, an oxidizable light-emitting pigment, undergoes enzymatic oxidation via the enzyme luciferase, resulting in the emission of photons. Relicanth is a clear homage to the living fossil coelacanth. Its design echoes a deep-bodied, ancient-looking coelacanth, featuring a bony head, lobed fins, and a mottled rock-like coloration. The real-life coelacanth is remarkable as a species, surviving virtually unchanged for hundreds of millions of years. It was long believed to be extinct until its dramatic rediscovery in 1938. Relicanth's tattered markings and irregular body patterns, including a distinctive red spot, may even resemble old treasure maps. Perhaps this is a nod to the coelacanth's connection to paleontology and geological discovery. It reminds me of the puzzle you had to solve in Pokémon Emerald to get the Regitrio. First comes Wailord, last comes Relicanth. You needed to have Wailord in the front of your party and Relicanth in the last spot, and you had to use TM Dig in a cave full of messages in Braille. What a blast from the past! Pokémon games just don't do that stuff nowadays. Anorith and Armaldo draw inspiration from the Anomalocaris, meaning abnormal shrimp. It is unlike other shrimp. This enigmatic prehistoric marine arthropod originated as a top predator during the Cambrian explosion more than 530 million years ago. This was a period of time where complex life rapidly diversified. Anorith's wings at the side of its body closely resemble the Anomalocaris' side lobes, used for undulating swimming in the primordial seas. Its two large claws mirror the Anomalocaris' prehensile frontal appendages to grip its prey firmly. While Anorith closely resembles Anomalocaris, Armaldo seems to be a stylized fictional extrapolation, evoking composite design elements of trilobites, mantis shrimps, or possibly even sea scorpions. Overall, the design tries to reconstruct Cambrian fauna with a clear prehistoric marine arthropod aesthetic. Lileep and Cradily are based on crinoids, or sea lilies. These tend to be sessile organisms that superficially resemble flowers, but are actually animals despite their plant-like appearance. Their designs reflect the stalked bodies and feathery, petal-like arms of crinoids, which they use to filter food from the water. Cradily exhibits eye spot mimicry, with eye-like spots on top of Cradily's head above its true eyes that could deceive onlookers into thinking Cradily's face is higher and larger than it actually is. Omanyte and Omastar are based on ammonites, extinct marine mollusks related to modern-day cephalopods. Meant to be a creature somewhere between sea snails and squids, Omanyte and Omastar are characterized by their iconic spiral-shaped chambered shells. According to their Pokédex entries, these ammonite Pokémon hunted plankton and small fish using their dexterous tentacles. In 2014, Omanyte and Omastar became legendary figures during the chaotic and crowdsourced experiment Twitch Plays Pokémon, where thousands and thousands of people controlled a single game of Pokémon Red. The Helix fossil was frequented on accidental purpose from the inventory as a divine relic, cementing and elevating Omanyte as Lord Helix, god of the Church of Helix religion. Based on official artwork from the Pokémon Fossil Museum, Kabuto and Kabutops seem to be based on horseshoe crabs. From the original Pokédex entries of Generation 1 Pokémon, Kabuto is said to be the ancestor of both hermit crabs and turtles. They kept themselves sheltered in their tough shell. They appear to have disliked fighting. They are thought to have been good swimmers, although not especially fast. Just recently, a Kabuto fossil was found in a mountain cave 1,000 meters above sea level. Its discovery revealed that the area had once been submerged under the sea. Clampearl, the bivalve Pokémon, is inspired by giant clams and oysters. Like marine oysters and freshwater mussels, it forms a pearl inside its shell. Its design reflects the biology of these mollusks, which uses layers of nacre to gradually form pearls around irritants trapped inside their shells. Huntail and Gorbis appeared to be conjoined in its beta design, but sometime in the design process it became split into two separate Pokémon. Huntail could be a gulper eel, moray eel, oarfish, or some other kind of eel. When we start listing several different species, it means we don't know exactly what the Pokémon is based on. We're just making stuff up and you can't prove it wrong because there's no official source. Otherwise, Gorbis seems best represented by the long-nosed chimera that wears a shell bra. Manaphy and Fionn appear to be based on Cleone, also known as sea angels. These are ethereal free swimmers, tiny transparent marine mollusks that feed on small marine animals. These otherworldly creatures drift gracefully through cold ocean waters, using their fin-like arms to fly through the sea. Manaphy and Fionn echo several features of sea angels, including their wing-like appendages, soft blue coloration, and antennae. Furthermore, the glowing red jewel in the center of their bodies could reference the visible red internal organs within the translucent bodies of Cleone. Claritza and Clauncher are based on pistol shrimp, known for their distinctive oversized claw. These bright blue crustacean-like Pokémon are also titled the Howitzer Pokémon, which is no accident. Claritza's massive claw functions like a high-powered cannon, capable of launching compressed water blasts with enough force to pierce the hull of a ship, mirroring the powerful shockwaves real pistol shrimp used to stun prey. Scraup and Dragalge are inspired by leafy and weedy sea dragons, marine fish known for their elaborate leaf-like appendages that provide exceptional camouflage among seaweed and kelp. Similarly, these Pokémon are designed to resemble drifting, decaying seaweed. They mimic the appearance of decomposing kelp, blending in with aquatic foliage to hide from predators and ambush prey. This also ties into their poison typing. Scraup feeds on rotten seaweed to produce toxins, while Dragalge's venom is said to be so potent it can corrode metal, sinking ships that stray into its territory to the bottom of the sea. Staryu and Starmie are clearly starfish, but there is a more subtle design inspiration from the Japanese superhero show Ultraman. This is taken from Bulbapedia because I'm not going to claim to be an expert on all things Ultraman. Apparently, Starmie is also a superhero called Starfish Man, or Hitode Man. References to Ultraman include Starmie's ties to outer space, beam attacks, and a gem in the middle acting like a heart. The anime even seems to rip vocal effects from Ultraman. Listen to this. Tentacool and Tentacruel are unmistakably jellyfish. From the long-lost Pokédex of the first generation of Pokémon, it states that 99% of their body is composed of water. Tentacruel have 80 tentacles with venomous needles that induce poisoning and full-body paralysis. For these qualities, they are called the gangsters of the sea. Tentacruel's beta design had a lot more tentacles, but it appears most were removed when Tentacruel was created later in development, so it looked weaker than its evolved form. One more fact about Tentacruel is that it was named Manowar in the Pokémon Red and Blue beta after the Portuguese Man of War. Seal and Dewgong are seal-based designs. The final design for Seal is very different from the original Gen 1 beta sprite, but the idea was clearly meant to be a pinniped-like creature or an aquatic fin-footed mammal. No Dewgong beta sprite has been discovered, which could imply that Dewgong wasn't created until years later. Finally, Sphiel, Celio, and Walrein are inspired by seals, sea lions, and walruses. Sphiel's beta design suggests that it was based on a bowling ball rolling over bowling pins. The spots on sea ball resemble finger holes on a bowling ball, a vestige that remains on current-day Sphiel. Celio's penchant of rolling balls on its nose could be a reference to the same behavior done by sea lions. Lastly, Walrein's massive tusks draw inspiration from walruses. Layers of the ocean. I took a few marine biology papers in university. They were absolutely fascinating, but they were also honestly incredibly stressful. One marine biology course in particular had assessments almost every week. We'd learn new content in week 1 and be tested on it in week 2. In week 3, we'd have a lab assignment while starting a new module. The pattern alternated so that we'd have a topic test every even week and lab assignments every odd week. What made it so intense was that every single test counted towards your final grade, so you had to study your ass off every week. You had to strive for perfect scores 100% every time. Getting A+ is more about not losing marks than it is about gaining marks, because every mark you lose adds up fast. And all of this was on top of the workload from other courses, even though this one clearly expected to be your top priority. However, by the end of the semester, when it came to the final exam, it was like one of the easiest exams I've ever taken, because they made us do the hard yards every week. If you enjoyed the video, leave a like, subscribe, and share the love. Check out my playlist for videos on the same topic. This is the 10th episode of Project Origin of Species, Pokemon Design Inspirations. Thank you for watching.